Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. One of the most dangerous things a human being can face in their life is that an absolute truth or an absolute belief in their lives is challenged when they thought that that belief was 100% correct. This can shatter lives of humans, people can kill themselves, it can really act completely unexpectedly on humans. Let me give you an example. The mother you grew up with, or the father you grew up with, or the parents you grew up with, you never ever question yourself, are these my parents or not? Especially when you're a child, you just go on, and unless your parents are completely different, say they are from Japan and you look like somebody from South Africa, then in which case you know that these people aren't your parents. But without those visual cues, you always will think that these people are your parents. Okay? How about if you are in your 20s and somebody comes to you and says, you know what, that person there, the father or the mother, is actually not your father or not your mother. These are not your parents. Do you see how this piece of information can actually shatter your life? It can put everything upside down. Tons of questions will come up, and everything, your emotions will be upside down, your way of thinking, the way you look at the world, the way you trust people, and all that kind of stuff. Okay? Now, the same thing happens here. How about if an absolute belief that you hold in your heart, you believe in that it is al-Islam, and then someone comes and challenges you right into that belief, and you cannot defend it. You just say, well, this is what it is. For example, we all know that they tell you that Islam is built upon five pillars. It is a matter no one will discuss this. But actually, Islam is not built upon five pillars. That is a statement, and I've already covered this. It's on my YouTube channel. Please just go back to it and look for it. I forgot the title. But Islam is not built upon five pillars. Pillars. So how many pillars is it? Well, you'd be happy to know that there are some companions that will say that Islam is built on 300 pillars, all the way down to one pillar, that is to believe in Allah alone. And between them two, you can see from 300 and above to one, that is a big number. Allah in the Quran has not said that Islam is built on any pillar for that matter. So where did this idea of Islam is built on five pillars? Well, politics again and history. So you see, now if someone comes and challenges you on this, or you go, what? Hang on, I'm aware of this. Now it's your duty to go and research. Another example that I'm going to give you, because you see, we have been, the way Islam is in our lives today, is a political school of thought Islam, crafted by religious institution. In Egypt, it's by Al-Azhar University. In Saudi Arabia, it's by the Medina University, or the whole concept of Saudi Arabia as they perceive it. In Tunisia, it's Zaytuna University, and so on and so forth. To give you an example of the problems you face, let's take an example. And that is the birth of a child. We all know, and it's in Bukhari and Muslim, in all kinds of books of hadith, that they say that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us that the baby and the creation of the baby step by step. I'm not talking about the Quran, I'm talking about the hadith. This is a very well known hadith about the human's creation from the parent, the moment the parent's sperm meets, till life is blown into the baby. This hadith is not only mentioned as a piece of information, but it actually carries with it some really serious, really, really serious endings, some really great calamities, as you will see. Those calamities defy both Islam and science. This hadith is so highly regarded that the scholars, our scholars of the Sunni world, who designed our Islam in the 3rd century at the time of Al-Mutawakkil. Just to refresh your memory, because I've spoken about this Mr. Al-Mutawakkil, but it's something to refresh your memory, because we need it greatly in this talk, especially about the decree and predestination. This king, Al-Mutawakkil, is al-mutawakkil is the one who relies on Allah. Okay, so if I have to translate, I would say the relier, and you will understand. Oh, the relier on Allah. That's what it is. The Abbasi kings are back in time. They used to give themselves this kind of titles. His name is completely different, but I'm not going to bother you with that. But he is well known as al-mutawakkil, the relier. This king is so well loved by our scholars because it is him who freed Ahmed ibn Hanbal from jail. You know the Mu'tazila and the creation of the Quran and that kind of stuff that happens before, yeah? And again, Mu'tazila, go back to talk number 2 when I speak about the 5 groups and how they affect our Islam, and you will find that I speak about Al-Mu'tazila there. But anyway, this man became well-liked and respected when he, subhanAllah, he flogged someone. This man one day, Al-Mutawakkil, when he flogged somebody just because that person was reported to have insulted Abu Bakr, Umar, Aisha, and Hafsa. So he insulted the first Khalifa, the second leader of the believers, the wife of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Aisha, and our mother, also the wife of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Hafsa. So Al-Mutawakkil, or the relier, flogged him. So when he did that, the Muslims and the scholars and the Sunni scholars at that time were extremely happy. And by doing that, he gained the quickest way to get into the Muslim masses, because the scholars like him, they're gonna praise him, and people are gonna like him, and it worked like fire. It worked like fire in a dried field. And in no time, let's say, the Sunni scholars were all over him, and they excessively praised him in their books, poetry, books, writings, and they even said that al-khulafa, the successors to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, are 3 people. There is Abu Bakr, who came after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam because he fought the dissidents, people who wanted no more to be Muslims. And Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, the Umawi, who came about 8 years later from Abu Bakr, for returning the stolen wealth taken by his predecessors, the Umayyah. You see what the Banu Umayyah did before Umar ibn Abdul Aziz came, and he started from Muawiyah all the way to him, is that they used to tax Muslims. The jizyas, we know it as the jizya, the tax. They used to tax Muslims themselves and take their wealth. And wrongly and unjustly, but that's what they did. So when Umar ibn Abdul Aziz alayhi rahmatullah came, he did 2 great things. One, he returned the stolen wealth to its own people, and that's why they say in his time the barakah came and a lot of wealth was abandoned. It's just because he returned the stolen wealth to the people of his town, anyway, Sham and all that kind of stuff. And number 2, he stopped the cursing of Ali on Jum'ah. You know, when the imam delivers the khutbah, at the end of the khutbah, if you realize, he always, always will mention, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدِّ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيْتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَيَنْهَى. So that part of that ayah, instead of it, they used to straight away start cursing. Allah curse Ali. Allah curse. Ali is the husband of Fatima. Ali is the cousin of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ali is the father of Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn. He was cursed for political reasons. Just like today, the Muslim Brotherhood and the Shia, everyone is cursed by the Sunni world. It's strange. It really repulses me a great deal when I see how much politics have played in our beautiful Islam. But this is not about that. It's about Mr. Al-Mutawakkil. So they say, and the third one is Al-Mutawakkil. They actually equaled Al-Mutawakkil to Abu Bakr and Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. And why Mr. Al-Mutawakkil, or the relier, became such a big shot? Just because he fought Al-Mu'tazila. And he supported the Sunni scholars. And that's it. And it became for him a great praising, Al-Mutawakkil, the third Khalifa. So to them, Allah al-Azim, politics are a curse, but what can we say? But anyhow, the Islam we have today was well designed and documented in the 3rd century. And when you are asked to believe and follow an Islam, or to follow the companions, or to understand the Quran and the Sunnah according to how the Sahaba, the companions, understood it, well, guess what? The companions did not document how they understood it. The companions, they just believed in it. It's 250 years later and up, that some people got together and started writing what these people believed that the companions understood. So we actually, even the hardcorest, if that is the term, Salafi, when they tell you, you got to understand the Quran and Sunnah according to how the companions understood it, I always tell them, no. You understand the Quran and the Sunnah according to how the scholars who wrote about those companions understood it. It's not the companions. We don't have anything. We don't even have a single page written by one companion. And it's really a calamity. But anyhow, Al-Mutawakkil, for your information, so that you get a good idea about when the Islam we have today was written, he was crowned as a king 232 years after the migration of our messenger. If you don't know how much that is, it's 847 Christian era. Take your calculator and 2019, as we are in this year, minus 847, and you will get how long we can go back to the Islam we have today. I don't wish to dive in that much into history, however. There is a minimum ground that you must possess to be able to understand that the mess we are in these days is actually been designed not at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but rather 300 years later on. Now let us go back to the human's creation. This hadith states that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, the companion, the great companion from Mecca radiallahu anhu, says that haddathana, i.e. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that wa huwa as-sadiq al-masduq, and he is the true and truly validated man. What this means is, when you hear a hadith, that this is a great validation for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he needn't that. Allah has validated Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But the reason they put this in this hadith is that they don't question, is that you, the listener, you don't question anything in this hadith. The most, in my own belief, Abdul Salam, this is the most dangerous hadith on earth. Many people have quitted Islam on this, and this hadith doesn't make sense at all. From head to toe, from the very beginning, inna, to the last one, and you will see. The hadith goes something like this, and I don't believe 1,000 times that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had ever spoken these horrible words. No way. It doesn't come from him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. From someone who has recited the Quran and has been validated and praised by Allah, he wouldn't say these words, and you will see why. He says, they say he said, "Inna khalqa ahadikum yujma'u fi batni ummihi 40 yawman wa 40 layla." There are variations of the hadith, but I chose this variation because it's kind of like comprehensive. It says, the hadith says, or the saying says, the creation of every one of you starts with the collection of the material for his body, i.e. the flesh will become everything, within 40 days and 40 nights in the womb of his mother. So we are collected there, yeah? So the sperms meet each other for 40 days and 40 nights. It's a matter of collection. I don't know how the sperm and the sperm of the woman collect each other. I don't know. But we'll see later on. Then he says, the sayings, ثُمَّ يَكُونُ عَلَقَةً مِثْلُهُ. Then he becomes a clot of thick blood of a similar period. I.e. for 40 days, we are just water into the wombs of our mothers. Then in the second 40 days, i.e. 80 days from there, we just become a thick blood, a thick cloth of blood. Okay? Then, said, ثُمَّ يَكُونُ مُدْخَةً مِثْلَهُ. Then he becomes like a piece of flesh for a similar period. So here we've reached the 120. So according to this hadith, for the 40 days, first 40 days, we are just sperm and water dingling around in mommy's tummy. That's it. The sperm keeps chasing the egg. That's it. Come here. No. For 40 days until they get tired, then they turn into a piece of blood. And for 40 days, that piece of blood doesn't know what to do. And then for the next 40 days, they turn into a piece of flesh. And then comes the biggest danger. ثم يبعث إليه الملك فيؤذن بأربع كلمات. Then an angel is sent to him by Allah. That's what they put in the translation. And the angel is commanded and allowed to write four things. And this is where our calamity comes in. Oh God. فَيَكْتُبُ رِزْقَهُ. And then the angel will write its livelihood. I.e. whatever you're going to get, and this is the general belief. If some, look at in the way Muslims talk today, if they do a deal and it doesn't work, they go, well, it's not written. Because they all believe that that deal, were it written, then you would have made it. Because it was not written, then it's not written for you, and you don't get it. And then they say, وَأَجَلَ, and then his death, the time of his death. وَشَقِيٌّ أَمْ سَعِيدٌ, and whether he, she will be a miserable person, or a happy person, or a good life, or a bad life person. ثُمَّ يَنْفُخُ فِيهِ الرُّوحِ, and then the soul is breathed into him. And this is a big lie. And then the hadith carries on, and this saying carries on, فَإِنَّ أَحَدَكُمْ لَيَعْمَلُ بِعَمَلِ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ, so one of you may do good deeds, the deeds of the people of paradise, i.e. the deeds that will get you to paradise. حَتَّى لَا يَكُونُ بَيْنَهَا وَبَيْنَهُ إِلَّا ذِرَعَ, until the length or the distance between that person and paradise is an arm length, i.e. so much close to getting into paradise. فَيَسْبِقُ عَلَيْهِ الْكِتَابِ, and then what has been written for him takes precedence. And then he does the acts of hellfire and he enters hellfire. What this hadith says, it's a lie. I don't believe a split of a second. Bukhari, Muslim, all the scholars and books and tons of books, and now everybody explains this hadith, and I tell you, it's a lie from head to toe. What this hadith tells me is that I spend, or you spend, your entire life doing extremely good, and suddenly at the life towards the end of your life, when you are an old man, let's say you are an old man, and someone, I don't know, what is this deed that you are going to do? Okay, let's take the words, yeah? So you're talking to your kid, and the kid really gets into your nerves, you're totally angry, you're reciting the Quran, you take the Quran and you throw it against the wall. Okay, it's a vile of an act. It doesn't do anything. You throw the Quran, it's not a big deal. Musa alayhi salam threw the tablets taken from Allah, from Jibreel, who gave them to him. And when he saw the children of Israel misguided, Musa alayhi salam threw the tablets on the floor. وَأَلْقَى الْأَلْوَاحَ وَفِيهَا هُدًى, and he threw the tablets and there were guys. Allah says this, but Allah didn't tell him, Musa, you are a disbeliever. But let's assume, because in the sights of Muslims, if you do this act, you actually have killed the humanity. You can lie, you can backbite, but you can't physically throw the Quran. Okay, so let's say this old person, or myself, or whatever it is, you throw the Quran and you want to say something, and you say a blasphemous word, and then you have a heart attack and you die. According to this hadith, you're doomed to hellfire for eternity. It doesn't matter. You've spent 60, 70 years doing your salat and doing goods, doing charity. It doesn't matter according to the hadith. And this is absolutely nonsense. This has created a problem for the scholars, and they tried to justify it. Oh God, you can't believe the lies and turning and tormenting this hadith so that they get out of this problem. And guess what? They couldn't. And still insist the hadith is authentic. Where is Allah's justice? Ya khi, ya Allah, if you knew, well, Allah knows, but since you knew I was going to do this at the end of my life, why didn't you give me a hint when I was in my teens so that I can go and have fun, you know, music for rock and roll, drugs, do whatever I want to do, kill, do everything. I'm going to hellfire anyway. And then you tell me, now the other part of the hadith comes in, وَإِنَّ أَحَدَكُمْ لَيَعْمَلُ بِعَمَلِ أَهْلِ النَّارِ, and one of you will do the deeds of the people of hellfire, i.e. those people that are going to hellfire. حَتَّى مَا يَكُونُ بَيْنَهَا وَبَيْنَهُ إِلَّا ذِرَعَ, until there is an arm length distance between the person and hellfire, i.e. they're going to enter it. And guess what? فَيَسْبِقُ عَلَيْهِ الْكِتَابِ, then what has been written on his book, the final book, and then فَيَعْمَلُ عَمَلْ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ, and then they will do a deed of the people of Jannah, فَيَدْخُلَهَا, and then they enter it. What kind of religion is this? So let's take Pablo Escobar, yeah? The man who ruined the world, drugs, killings. Oh, God, go on YouTube, do research about Pablo Escobar, and you can see that he is a drug pin, one of the lords of drugs, and he has caused murders. Oh, God, you don't want to... Okay, this person, for the entirety of their lives, they do evil, vile, kill, drugs, murders, extortion, everything. And then just one day when he is about 2 hours or 1 hour away from death, suddenly he does an act of goodness of the people of paradise. He dies on that, he goes to Jannah. What kind of justice is this? But this is what has been preached to us for the last 1400 years, so much so that it's so grounded in us. Oh, this is not written, Yahi. Oh, and we have this sickness of belief running in our blood. And then they say, Rawahu al-Bukhari and Muslim, and countless of other scholars. This hadith is a complete chaos. So much so, I will tell you what the problems we're living in. In the books, anyone who studies usul al-fiqh, the roots of fiqh, anyone who studies the hadith and things like that, at the very beginning, as they taught us when those shuyukh used to teach us from Saudi Arabia, for those intensive courses that we used to have for years, back in the 80s, late 80s, beginning 90s, they used to teach us that al-Islam is built on 4 ahadith. Let's say it's no longer 5 pillars, now we have 4 ahadith. What are those 4? It's not 4 ayat from the Quran, it's not on the Quran, no. It's 4 ahadith. What are those ahadith? إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ. The outcome of actions depends on the intentions. Why they say? Because that's the heart of intention, blah, blah, blah. And number 2, من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فوارد. Whoever innovates something into this religion of ours, it'll be rejected. And they talk about the bid'ah and things like that, which is only a key to call us disbelievers, because none of us is free for what innovation is. And innovation is what they think is innovation, it's not what Allah thinks, what Allah wants from us. No, it's what they think. But anyhow, the 3rd hadith, لا ضرر ولا ضرار. No, you don't harm yourself and you don't harm other people. The 4th hadith, this hadith that I'm talking about, the creation of the baby and things like that. And this hadith has caused a huge headache for our scholars, which says, subhanAllah, because there is another hadith with the same content, but the angels doesn't blow life in this baby on the 120th day. The angel blows life in the 42nd day, 42 days, and the other one in 120. And anyone who has been pregnant, ladies, anyone who has been a father, anyone of us who has been married or is still married, knows that the baby is alive within the first month. It's not like he's completely dead until the 120th day. I used to wonder before, after my first child and second child, I used to think, I'm going to the doctor 3 months and we go and they have a listen here and they tell us and we are all happy. Yeah, you know, the baby's coming. And I used to think to myself, how can the doctor say that the baby is alive and he's healthy when the angel hasn't blown life into it? How is that possible? I couldn't understand back then because my brain was so Salafist that even if the reality is right in front of my eyes, I still was blind to it. And also this issue of when does the angel blow life into the baby, 120 or 42 days, has created a huge problem with abortion of babies. Would you believe it in our books of fiqh? And this is so, makes me vomit, makes me puke, really, really makes me, oh God. They say if a baby either gets aborted or for a reason or another, the mother loses the baby. If it is before 120 days, our scholars have written in our books of fiqh, and I pray to Allah that the world doesn't get to know this. But subhanAllah, many Salafists and well-educated people in Islam have gone into Christianity, and now they have satellite stations on YouTube, and they are actually blowing the whistle. They're doing a good job at it because a lot of Muslims now are turning away from Islam into Christianity. Guess what they say, these scholars of ours? I am doing almost the same thing as they are, but I am calling you more towards the Quran. The book of Allah, you are safe. They can't argue with you. But hadith and saying of the scholars, and you are walking in a minefield. But anyhow, this is what they say. If a mother loses her child prior to 120 days, 119, and you go all the way down, or the abortion takes place, what has happened, that baby, إِنَّمَا هُوَ قِطْعَةُ لَحْمٍ, it is just a piece of flesh, يُضَمُّ فِي رِقَّةٍ, you just put it in a piece of cloth, you turn that piece of cloth on it, ثُمَّ يُرْمَى فِي حُفْرَةٍ, then is thrown into a hole in earth, ثُمَّ يُغَطَّى, then it is covered. I'm talking about a baby here. فَوَلَا يُصَلَّى عَلَيْهِ, there shouldn't be a salat janazah on it. وَلَا يُسْتَغْفَرْ لَهُ, and you should not ask repentance for it and anything, because it was just a dead piece of meat. So much so that some questions asked to great scholars, Al-Fawzan, Bin Baz, Ibn Uthaymeen, these big shot celebrities, right? They are asked, what is the ruling of such a baby? The baby has been in the mother's, say, 3 months and a half, and then she loses the child. Will that child be resurrected on judgment day? Will the parents see that father, that son? Guess what the scholars say? No, that kid will. It's not like they interfered with his own life. They even put their noses into Allah's business. No, the child is not going to be resurrected. No, the child is not going to be this. No, the child is not going to be that, because he was just a piece of flesh. Is this really... Ya Allah. Now, let me tell you something that you need to know about this hadith and countless other hadith that are so-called miracles, but because there are really, really no miracles at all. These days, just like before, our scholars insist that this hadith is a great sign from Allah given to His Messenger, as if the Quran was not enough. But we had to have this kind of hadith. Why? So that people know that the Messenger of Allah spoke the truth. But when did this truly happen? Why did these people needed what the Messenger had to say so that people believe that the Messenger is truly a Messenger from Allah and a guide to humanity, to their Lord? So where did this information come from? Well, let me tell you what happened. When Muslims, after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, started disobeying Allah by attacking other nations under the banner of spreading Islam. Whenever today you talk to people about politics or how Banu Umayyah were tyrants, how they killed, they will always tell you, but they promoted, they spread Islam in the lands. They went, Yahi, and they called us al-futuhat, the opening, the conquests. Well, it's not the opening, it's not the conquest. We Muslims today, we say that the West has colonized us. Istamaruna, they came to our lands, took our goodness. This is exactly what we Muslims did. Why did we have to go to Turkey? Why did we have to go to North Africa? Why did we have to force Islam on other people in the name of spreading Islam? But this is again a talk for another day, and I'll deal with this when I come, inshallah, to the study of hadith. But today I want to just tell you about a piece of information that you need to know. That piece of information is this. When the Muslims expand and kind of like just extended and expanded their tentacles on the land around them, especially in Banu Umayyah, and later on in Banu Abbas, and then after that the Turkish people, tons of people from different cultures, from different worlds came to Islam. You have the Iranians, you have the Iraqis, you have the Syrians, you have the Turkish, you have the Cyprus, you have all from the Greeks, you have all Romans, all these people came to Islam. But when they came to Islam, they did not start from zero. Each one brought their own culture and just added a little bit of Islam on top of it. For example, Pakistan, when they came, or Bangladesh and Indians, they actually didn't change much. They, when you go there, they're still Indians, they're still Pakistanis, they're still Bengalis. But guess what? They just added the layer on top of them, and that's how they became Muslim. So when Muslims started preaching Islam to these people, they had a dilemma. They were faced with a dilemma. That dilemma was as such. Quran, those people don't understand Arabic. So you can't really preach Quran to them in Arabic. But people came from different, let's say from the Iran, yeah, or the Greek people. The Greek, they had Zeus, they had all those great goddesses, Athena, they have all this. So when they came into Islam, the Iranians came into Islam, they started telling us about Muhammad. Who is this Muhammad? The Arabs couldn't tell them, oh, you know what, Muhammad is just the messenger of Allah, because he just doesn't have anything else to add to that. It should have been just the Quran. So what the Muslims started doing, they started inventing stories for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to make it equivalent to what the Persians veneered or loved or respected. So if the, for example, yeah, if the Christians came to Islam to convince them that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a prophet, things like that, well, Jesus walked on water, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had water come from his own fingers. So they invented miracles. And again, please bear with me as I cover this in the world of a hadith. But here is what happened, and this is extremely dangerous. At the time of Al-Ma'mun, who is the child of Harun al-Rashid, all these are kings of the second dynasty of Al-Abbasid dynasty. When Al-Ma'mun came, he was very close to Al-Mu'tazila. Al-Mu'tazila are the scientists, put the brains. All the inventions that you hear, or the contributions of Islam into science and the inventions, they were Al-Mu'tazila. It's just because we're a bunch of liars. When we want to use the Mu'tazila, we make them Muslim. And when we don't want to use them, we just throw them away. But anyhow, all the inventions and all what Islam, math and scientists and Ibn Sina and the Farabi and the Jabir ibn Hayyan, all these great scholars were Mu'tazila. But anyhow, Al-Ma'mun was very close to Al-Mu'tazila, because they were researchers, they were scientists, they were, and he loved that. He promoted science, and he did something very beautiful and dangerous at the same time. The Arabs started translating books from other cultures. One of such cultures, the Greek culture. When the Arabs started translating books from the Greek cultures, they found that these Greeks were 1,000 years away in advancement in all kinds of things, in physics, in surgeon, philosophy, medical research, antiquity, anatomy, physiology, pathology, pharmacology, neurology, logics, math, thinking, processing, everything. The Greeks had such a huge impact on civilization. So now we start, the Muslims are faced with a big problem. Those great science, they have done that. So what do you Muslims have? And that is the big problem. So when Al-Ma'mun, the seventh king of the Abbasid dynasty, again, he was born in the year 170 after the death of Rasulullah. 170 years he was just born, okay? He was crowned later on, but he was, that is 786 Christian era. Get your maths, 2019, 786. What you find, that's how long ago that man existed. And he died 318. 833 Christian era, he was aged 47 years of age. He was a pioneer in the translation of other nations' books. And amongst such books that was translated is a book written by something called Galen, or the Arabs would call him Gelianus. And that man, the book that they translated from Greek into Arabic, the title was extremely interesting. It's called Jawami'ul Mani, or the sperm collections. How the sperm collection? And from this book came what you read, that the hadith, the collection of the baby 40 days, it was literally taken from Galen's book and attributed to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as he was a sire. Guess why? So that the Greek people, the Iranian, the Iraqian, the Turkish, and all those people that lived in that part of the world would say, oh, you have Galen? Galen did that? Well, Muhammad knew that. Allah mentioned that to him. And when you take this book of Jawami' al-Mani, the sperm collection written by Galen, you can go online and search for this, G-A-L-E-N, man, and you will find that this guy has contributed greatly to science. And this is where this hadith comes from. Of course, what the scholars, our scholars did, they did something very malicious. At one point, there was a huge debate and a huge argument between the scholars of Islam about, has Allah written our actions or not? A great, huge majority were, no, Allah has not written. And the people of Hadith, the scholars of Hadith, Bukhari, Muslim, and things like that, and those who resembled them, they were of the Ahmed ibn Hanbal and so on. They were of the argument that Allah wrote everything before it happened. So much so that Ahmed ibn Hanbal said that the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, that when, for example, when they came at night crying to their father after they did what they did to Yusuf, Ahmed ibn Hanbal said that story, Allah had already written exactly how it would happen, and he wrote it in Al-Quran, and that's how it happened. And that's how we ended up headlong against the wall, and we never moved. And that's why Saudi Arabia today, which is the cradle of Ahmed ibn Hanbal and his thinking, is the most backward, tyrannic, stupid land on earth, and they claim they know more. That's the problem. It's when someone is stupid and they think they are smart. But anyhow, so exactly when you go back to Galen's book about the sperm collection, you find that that man there at that time, he was the first one to start writing, or not the first one, but he was of the great scientists that found out that the baby is made from the mother and the father, that there are babies, and he did his research according to his time. They didn't have microscopes and all those things that we have today, all the advancement equipment, but he did what he did, so that Muslims don't feel idiotic and stupid in front of this great civilization of Greeks. Guess what? They invented the hadith that we are 40 days, 40 days, 40 days. Why is this hadith such a big lie? Because we live on the 21st century. Okay? And it might seem strange to you. But however, if you go, as I said, if you have been a mother and you got pregnant and you have children, and most of us do, and those who don't, I pray to Allah that one day you become parents and you will see this for yourselves. Once your wife feels that she is pregnant and you start getting to the doctor, guess what? You will find that the progress of the baby is completely different. And to illustrate that, let me put this into your... I'm going to go week 1, week 2, week 3, until I think week 11. So that we see, does this hadith hold against science or not? Because it's amazing. So week 1 and week 2. That's when your body, as the mother gets ready, assuming the sperm is inside you. And guess what? And it will seem strange, very strange, but for the first 2 weeks, you actually are not yet pregnant. Because what happens is, the conceptual, occurs about 2 weeks after your last period. So let's say you slept with your husband a week before you get your menses. And then nothing happens. You get your menses, nothing happens. And then right after you get your menses, that's when you get fertilized. And then, so the pregnancy doesn't start from when the sperm met your body, it's rather later on, after you get your last period. And that's why when you go to a doctor, they always ask you when was your last period, and then they take 2 weeks from that date, and that's how they calculate 9 months. And most of the time, it's not pretty much accurate, within days, but you always deliver on time. So that's week 1 and week 2. Nothing happens in there. So now, assuming you had your menses, your periods, and you get fertilized. And that happens in week 3. The sperm and egg happily unite. They go on a date, have dinner together, and then they go, they struggle for a walk, and they end up in some tubes called the fallopian tube. It's one cell. The two of them become one cell entity. And in the world of science, it's called a zygote. The zygote is when both sperms and the egg, or both sperms, become one entity. Just like when you make coffee and tea and water, and they become one entity. Okay? So the zygote is already, and this is week 3, is already well and alive. Pay attention. You are alive. Your husband is alive. His sperm is alive. Your sperm is alive. When the two alive meet together, why should they wait for another 4 months until the baby, the angels blow life into them? Are we crazy or not? Subhanallah. But as I said, in our, the way they teach us today is they teach you Islam, and they also sedate you so that you don't ask questions, you don't question what they tell you. You just take it right in there. So week 3, fertilization happens, and And guess what? The zygote is there and he is happy, alive, and you start feeling certain. Some ladies vomit, some ladies feel dizzy. Each woman will interact with that, react to that thing there differently, but she gets the signs that something within her hair changed. And this happens in week 3. Week 4 is what called the implantation. And this is like this ball, the little fur ball of the water starts dividing, the cells start dividing on themselves. And that's, they start getting bigger. And this, and that is the when the outer layer of the placenta will develop, and the baby starts feeding from that placenta from week 4. That's it. It's a human being. Allahu Akbar. 5 weeks into that pregnancy, the hormone levels increase in your baby. And this is, the 5th week, but actually it's 3rd week from your pregnancy, remember, from your menstrual cycle. So but I'm going to go week 5. And the level of hormone produced by you, the mother, quickly increases the signals to your ovaries to stop releasing eggs and produce more estrogen, because now that's when you finish your menstruation ends, because the body has received commands from your the ovaries, the uterus, that you must stop producing ovaries, and turn on the estrogen and progesterone machines. We need those for the formation of the flesh and the baby and things like that. The level of hormones increase, the menstrual period stops, and the signs of pregnancy gets bigger, and you start actually seeing a small dot of a candy on your stomach. Okay, your baby's heart and a primitive circulatory systems will form in the layers of his cells, and this is at week 5. 35 days, it's already there. Okay, the mesoderm, this layer of cells, will serve as the foundation of our baby's bones. The bones, the skeleton starts forming on week 5, ligaments, kidneys, and much of the reproductive systems is produced on week 5. The inner layer of cells, the endoderm, is where our baby's lungs and intestine will develop. All this happens by week 5. Forget the 40 days and the 8. By the hadith, by the hadith, we still are a piece of cloth here and there. And by the science, and we see that science, the baby is already forming. Week 6, the neural tube closes. Okay, because this week the growth is very rapid. In just a few weeks after the conception, your tube and the baby's back is closing. The baby's brain and spinal cord is developing. The heart and other organs also start to form. Structures necessary to the developments of the eyes and the ears develop. Small buds appear that later on will become your arms. The baby's body begins to take a C-shape curvature. And that's in week 6, 7, 42 days. The baby is there. Week 7, the baby's head develops. Week 8, the baby's nose forms. Week 9, the baby's toes appear. Week 10, the baby's elbows bend. Week 11, the baby's genitals develop. Week 11, not week 16. So because if we have, according to the hadith, it's week 16. 120th days, week 16. But the science, it's in week 11. We can't, if I go to a doctor and on week 11 they tell me you have a girl, I can't turn to him and say, no, the hadith says it's 120 days. After that, the angels will come and blow the sex of the kid. How? No, it's not wrong. Science is wrong. Islam is correct. And this what has been with us for the last 1400 years. Even doctors, medical doctors today at the university, and I've studied with them, the Muslims, I used to argue back in time with them, and I used to tell them back in time when they used to bring this hadith, I tell them, science says, and you tell me this hadith says, wallahi, doctors, they can't find a way out of this calamity where the lies on Rasulullah ﷺ says that the babies, as I said, week one, month one, 41, for day first lap, 40, the second 40, the third 40, and so on. But Muslims today, what happens is when you have the doctors, people completely ignore this hadith. So my sisters and my brothers, between the week 7 and the week 12 of pregnancy, the foundation of your baby's sex organs develop. At about week 9, a baby's boy's genitals begin to process and the male becomes a male. For your information, all that you see in our genitals is actually the same thing. For example, yeah, when a boy grows, when the boy is born, he is born with a penis. When a girl is born, she is born with a clitoris. The clitoris is just the penis unformed. That's all there is to it. We, the male, we have the two testicles to process the testosterone. The women, if you, especially the mother and the father, you've seen the genitals of your baby daughters. Have you seen how the two sides of her genitals, of her vagina, how they are swollen? These are the unborn testicles. As the girl grows in life, and then they become, as is the vagina of a woman, the two sides, like the two pieces of flesh on the side of the vagina of women, these are the ungrown testicles. And they are formed between week 7 and 12. We cannot. That's why we have to open our world to questioning, especially 1,000%, the hadith. And now I want to get you into what, to understand what the term hadith means, what the Qudsi hadith means, and what is the difference between the hadith of the Rasulullah, the Qudsi hadith, or the sanctified hadith, and the Quran itself. At the beginning and before the 3rd century, what is known today as hadith was referred to as athar. Athar means a trace. So when someone says athar, or even if you go on Islam QA today and you look into Al-Munajjid's biography, they will tell you he's an athari, i.e. he follows the traces. What that means is that they didn't claim that what they had was a direct saying from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that it is just a trace of what they heard. It is till the famous 3rd century, Al-Mutawakkil, the relier on Allah, Ahmad ibn Hanbal Bukhari, came when the scholars who dealt with those traces started using the term hadith. At that time, the term hadith was used only for the Quran. أَفَمِنْ هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ تَعْجَبُونَ Allah says, is it from this hadith speech that you, people of Quraysh and the non-believers, are surprised? So at that time, before that 3rd century, back to Rasulullah, whenever they used the word hadith, they meant Al-Quran, and that was what was understood until came the dark century or the 3rd century when they started referring to the saying of Rasulullah as hadith. And slowly the term hadith became synonymous to the messenger's spoken words. And of course, later on, to force the whole argument of the Sunnah on us, they always, whenever there is the Sunnah, they say the spoken Sunnah, the acted Sunnah, and the agreement, disagreement Sunnah. And that what is what they want to tell us is that the hadith is no longer just a speech, but also is acts and all that kind of stuff. Then they maliciously invented the term Sunnah. It's an invented term, the Sunnah of Rasulullah. So much so, because it's a political term. And go back to my previous talks about, at the beginning when I spoke about Muawiyah and the impact, what the term Sunnah meant at the time, is all political. So much so that today, politically, what opposes the Shia is the Sunni. We say we are Sunni. It no longer is Quran, because Quran is followed by both the Shia and the Sunni. But now it's the other part that has divided Muslims for 1400 years, or at least 1100 years, the term Sunnah. And they tightly linked it with the Hadith. And now both of them mean the same thing. Hadith or Sunnah is always meant the same thing. And they always insist whenever they mention the Sunnah, it is what the Messenger said, did, approved, or disapproved. Even though, as I said, Allah calls the Quran hadith, but somehow, someone, somewhere, or some group in the days of past called the messenger's words, acts, and rulings as hadith. And as I said, slowly, the hadith became directly linked to the messenger. And even today, when you say, oh, the hadith, where does your mind go? It goes to what Rasulullah said, when in fact it should have been to the Quran. Countless ayat in Al-Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to his speech as hadith. What actually does the word hadith? The word hadith comes from hadatha. Hadatha happens. But hadith is a continuous act of happening. Also, in the way the Arabs deal with these words, if they say sayyaratul haditha, it's a brand new car, i.e. whatever you say is always new. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the term hadith, i.e. Allah talks to us. The talking of Allah is always as brand new. And the talking of Allah shall always happen and takes place. These things do not apply to what the Messenger said, but we are stuck now. The hadith in Bukhari, hadith in Muslim, and but the hadith of Al-Quran, we hardly ever mention it. This is why from now on, you will always hear me say the prophetic narratives, but I will not say the hadith of Rasulullah. Okay? Now that is one. So, the science of hadith is a very dodgy science. First, there was the hadith. Then second was the science of hadith designed by scholars later on. Today you hear that this is according to the condition of Al-Bukhari or the condition of Muslims. For your information, neither Al-Bukhari nor Muslim had documented their conditions for that matter. It's only later on that the scholars of Islam studied the books of Bukhari and Muslim, and it is the scholars that came with these conditions. Al-Bukhari and Muslim have no clue whatsoever. If Al-Bukhari came now and they will say to him, oh, this hadith is according to your conditions and terms, Al-Bukhari is going to look at them funnily. What defines which hadith is authentic or good and which hadith is not is actually not an agreed upon science. Bukhari has his own conditions. Muslim has his own. At-Tirmidhi has his own. Abu Dawud has his own, and so on and so forth. So much so that even the way At-Tirmidhi alayhi rahmatullah sorted out his book of Sunnah and Hadith and the terminologies he used, no one knows what he actually means. Many PhD theses have been discussed and written and all that kind of stuff, trying to figure out what actually does At-Tirmidhi mean when he said that this hadith is hasanun sahih, when he says this hadith is good, authentic, or when he says this hadith is hasanun gharib, or when he says that this hadith is good but strange. No one knows. Until Al-Albani came now and he took the other thing from At-Tirmidhi and he started calling the hadith in Tirmidhi sahih. But actually what At-Tirmidhi, how he refers to them, no one knows what At-Tirmidhi meant. So therefore when any scholar really claims that a hadith is authentic or not, many other scholars might agree or disagree with this person, either the chain of narrators or the content of the hadith itself, and which version of the hadith is more stronger than the other one. And when you take the whole science of hadith, you have a recipe for disaster. Therefore, the statement of classifying a hadith as authentic or not is not always as true as you think it is. And this has created a huge problem for us Muslims even these days. For example, in order for a hadith to be authentic or sahih, scholars say that it must unquestionably fulfill five conditions. Condition number one, all narrators at each and every step of the generation of the hadith must be of good character and must act justly in their day-to-day life. Of course, what makes a narrator acceptable to one person of a scholar and refused by another is a whole issue altogether. Some scholars, Al-Bukhari accepts a man, a Muslim refuses that man. To Al-Bukhari, that man is reliable and very good, he's 100%. To Muslim, no, that person is vile, and so on and so forth. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, one a great fan of Al-Bukhari, and they call him, the scholars nowadays, those who came after him until our days. They call Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani Amir al-Hadith. Amir al-Mu'minin fil Hadith. Like Umar ibn al-Khattab is the leader of the believers, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani is the leader of the believers in al-Hadith. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani is an expert construction builder. He is the greatest man to justify all the wrongdoings of al-Bukhari. He's so much big of a fan of al-Bukhari that it is Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani that whenever al-Bukhari screws up in a hadith, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani is the man that comes to patch up what al-Bukhari has messed. That's why it's called the patcher. And for your information, the version of al-Bukhari we have today in our hands, as I said before, we do not have the original book that al-Bukhari wrote. The earliest book written after the death of al-Bukhari is 80 years after the death of al-Bukhari. That's one. When Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani alayhi rahmatullah came and he wanted to comment and study the book of al-Bukhari and wrote what is known today as Fath al-Bari of Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, he found that there were many versions of what's called today Sahih al-Bukhari. In his introduction, he says that he studied the different versions until his heart settled in this particular version, and what he felt home with is the version he commented in and he explained, and that became our al-Bukhari. Note that there are other books, other versions of al-Bukhari, so that nobody plays with you and they tell you that al-Bukhari is the most authentic book after the book of Allah. Such statement is vile. It only can come from the mouth of a shaitan. Someone who knows the value of al-Quran would never ever equal a human's collection of sayings that has traveled through centuries to the book of Allah. It's like I see somebody, let me say Bruce Lee, everybody knows Bruce Lee, he's a powerful dude, he's bad, oh God, that man. And I tell you that Bruce Lee is the second strongest man after Allah. You see how vile the statement is? The same thing for al-Bukhari. Anyhow, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani in his book An-Nukat, An-Nukat is like the diary where he keeps his own thoughts and things like that. On page 286 and to page 287, he says that the number of narrators used by al-Bukhari only, apart from Muslim. Okay, so these are only al-Bukhari, what al-Bukhari has used, meaning that Muslim, the great Imam Muslim, did not use this hadith, is 435 narrators, with around 80 of them accused of being weak narrators. So al-Bukhari used a variety of 435 narrators. 80 of these people are considered by other scholars of hadith, including Muslim, as weak. For your information, Muslim is a student of al-Bukhari for 16 years. Muslim has not mentioned one hadith on the authority of al-Bukhari, and al-Bukhari has not mentioned one hadith on the authority of Muslim. It's like they hated each other, subhanAllah, or something. Now, the number of narrators used by Muslim only, meaning al-Bukhari did not accept the status of these narrators as of good standing. So Muslim used 620 narrators. 160 of these people, according to al-Bukhari, these people were weak. So you can understand now where the problems we faced with today are. There is tons I can say about this world, but I will leave that when I deal with the science of hadith, and there I will expand more. Point number two, they said that these people, they must have great precision and an infallible memory in what they are narrating. And this rule is never met, because all of our scholars agree that the hadith or the prophetic narration is only reported by meaning, not the exact wordings used by the Prophet ﷺ, except a very tiny percentage, less than 10. And that's what they call al-mutawatir lafziyan and ma'nan, i.e. the group, a huge number of people. For example, I'll give you an example. When we say Allahu Akbar in the Salat, that is mutawatir, because a great number of scholars, the companions, heard the messenger say Allahu Akbar. They did it and they reported it to us. There is no way, no margin for errors. So that is, yes, it's mutawatir, and we take, that's why we do the Salat the way we do it. But for the rest of the hadith, forget it. a great number of these people reported the hadith by meaning only. That's why it is a lie when we say the Messenger of Allah said, when it is in fact only a meaning of what he said. Okay? Number three, they say the narrators must have a continuous link between themselves from the beginning to an end. There must not be a break in the chain of narrators. Again, this rule isn't always present, even in Al-Bukhari and Muslim, and they have broken these rules. Nowadays, when people started busting Al-Bukhari, oh, this hadith is wrong and that hadith is wrong, the scholar said, oh, we forgot to tell you, there is a form of hadith that Al-Bukhari used, and that is Al-Mu'allaq. Al-Mu'allaq is when Al-Bukhari doesn't have a chain of narrators, or he traces it back to a certain people, then from there just suddenly jumps to Rasulullah ﷺ, and he leaves it hanging. Yes, hanging, yeah, right. But anyhow, point number four, the hadith is free from any oddness in its chain of narrators or the content. And by the word odd, what they mean is that each narrator narrates something that does not contradict the narrations of somebody else. So it's not odd, and needless to say that there is a huge percentage of sayings that do not fulfill this rule either. Number five, the hadith is free from faults in its chain of narrators and content. And a fault is a sin. They go into details about this, but believe me, the majority of hadiths have a problem with one or the other or both at the same time. Either the chain of narrators has got a problem, or the content, or both of them. Hardly ever you will find a hadith that doesn't have a problem. That's why we have Al-Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, because all these scholars did not accept what the other scholars did, so they wrote their own books. But anyhow, okay, I need to stop here, and because it's 1 hour already, and I will, inshallah, carry on part two. Again, this is your brother, Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa, and off to part two. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.